watching, reading the news. There was a sense in those weeks between Election Day and Inauguration Day that Americans were all in this together, preparing, flirting for what we didn't know. And maybe it's amazing.
The voice of our mockumentary is Andy Lancet. Katya Rogers is our executive producer. Jim Schachter is WNYC's vice president for news. On the Media is a production of WNYC Studio.
The Nightstand. And I feel that one. And there's no phone.
That's unusual, right?
It's a bit odd, right?
So Ryan can shuffle cautiously around to his knees, graze into things, and that's how he finds a sofa.
And so I turn to where I think there might be a table, and poof, there's a coffee table. So I grope this coffee table for a while. There's no phone on it.
Grope is kind of a funny word to use for this.
It sort of feels that way, though. You know, you just sort of... Because you don't know where anything begins or ends, so you really maul it.
He says that as he moves around any new place, he doesn't exactly draw a map in his head. He says that it's more like wandering around in a first-person video game. One where nothing is visible until he touches it. So, he figures, okay, let's see what is on the other side of this coffee table. And he edges forward in the room.
And I find there's a desk. And I'm like, aha, the desk, right? So I feel around on the desk, and there's a lamp, and there's a notepad I'll never use, and there's stuff, but there's no phone. So I'm left to my last sort of blind guy resort, which is I go back to the beginning, you know, back to the bed, and I find the wall, and I start Marceau-ing the walls. You know, I'm wiping them up and down, and I round the fourth corner, and I get to the bathroom, and I go past the bathroom, and there's nothing. And I feel behind me again, and the bed is back behind me again. So I've circled this room. Mm-hmm. And I even thought, well, maybe it's like a super fancy hotel. There's a phone in the bathroom, and I go in there, and there's nothing. So I circle the room two more times this way, wiping it down. I check the coffee table again, I check the desk again, and I just figure, forget it, I'll just go to bed and try again tomorrow.
So he goes to bed, doesn't call his wife, sleeps. And in the morning he wakes up to the sound of something curious.
It's sort of terrifying because I know the bed was there, and now there's a wall, and I keep touching the wall, thinking maybe this time it'll go away. And I go to the left, and there's another wall now. And I'm a grown man, and I'm lost in a hotel room.
So what's your next move? What do you do?
I ended up, like, doing the Marceau thing. I started wiping the walls, feeling my way along the edges, and it wraps back around until I find the bed is actually behind me.
Is there a part of the room that he hadn't encountered the night before? This was an alcove on a side of the bed that he just never discovered.
So here's what the room actually looked like. There are two coffee tables and two sofas on the left and the right side of the bed.
The mistake that he made the night before was this. When he was Marceau-ing the walls, he got three-fourths of the way around the room. He got to the last wall, and he didn't actually feel all the way along that wall until it met another wall. Basically, a little ways down that wall, felt that the bed was behind him. And when he realized that the bed was behind him, he figured he was done. He stopped feeling that wall. He just assumed the wall continued for another 8 feet or so, but it didn't continue. It stopped. It was this alcove.
And this is the problem. When you're blind, you just can't assume anything. And the problem is you get a picture in your mind, and if you get it wrong, you just live inside the mistake.
This kind of thing happens to him a lot. Way, way more than
it took me a long time to come to understand that blindness actually wasn't the main problem. The main problem was embarrassment. That, you know, I had to sort of give myself over to the slapstick of things.
To state the obvious, sometimes it is just a lot easier to see things. There's a lot of things out. And today on our radio show, we have all kinds of stories of people trying to take things that are normally invisible to them and make them visible. I'm talking about unspoken feelings, I'm talking about people's secret lives, I'm talking in a, very literal way about me and the other people doing stories on today's radio program. As people on the radio, usually we are invisible, but today we are bringing you excerpts from the show that we did on stage in front of people in New York City and then beamed into movie theaters all across the United States and Canada and Australia. Some of the stuff on the show, in fact, a lot of the stuff on the show was way too visual to put on the radio, but the rest of the show consisted of these great stories from David Sedaris and David Rakoff and Steve Notaro and others. We have a really nice show for you today. From WBEZ Chicago, it's This American Life. I'm Ira Glass. Stay with us.
Say to her, Papa sees what you see when you close your eyes, but mine are open. Which makes no sense to anybody. So the miscommunications began to pile up between us. One day I'm standing in the hallway of our house, and Tess either kicked or rolled this foam soccer ball to me. Foam soccer balls are really quiet. You see my problem. And it rolled by, yes. And I ignored it. But I didn't know it was there. And she got upset. She wanted to know why didn't I kick it back to her? Why didn't I want to play with her? And she began to cry. Now, I don't know what's going on at all. So I'm just saying things like, what's wrong, Punkin? And hey, why don't you go get your ball or something? You know, later on, my wife did see this happen later on, and only then did I learn how I was rejecting my kid all day. And part of me felt useless as a father, and another part of me just felt really angry at Nerf. Another time, I picked up Tess at a daycare, and, you know, Papa, Papa, she screams as I walk in, and she sees me, and I squat down, and I open my arms, and I wait for the hug, because, you know, it's best that I wait, because the floor is dotted with babies between us, and nothing ruins our sweet moment like me stomping on babies. So her body slams into mine, and she wraps herself in a monkey hug, and I tell her how much I missed her, and of course, to that, she cries. But she cried on the other side of the room. And suddenly, I feel this body, and it's not familiar, and in fact, it's a little boy. And Tess is crying, Papa, Papa, as if the word itself hurts on the other side of the room. And so, she just can't understand why I've hugged another child. And I chase after the sound of her, and I'm sorry about the babies. So the miscommunications piled up, and they were mostly just little heartbreaks. But sometimes they were dangerous. There's times when I would walk into the daycare in the morning, and I work at a university, and we'd walk across campus together in the morning, and she'd be in one of those NASCAR World Cage backpack things, which are great for blind fathers. And we'd make our way across campus, and it's beautiful, it's in the mountains, and it's forested. And I say this just so you can understand my legitimate panic, when from her backpack she said to me one of her few words. She said, there. Rose, what's that, Punkin? And I turn because I can still see some smears, so I look for a big black one. There. And I said, there? Like, we're going over there? And she's there, there, and she's getting more upset. There, there. Now, this is Canada. We're in the forest. This is the mountains. And the bears love our dumpsters. They dine frequently.
By the way, is the band OK Go playing a song, Handbells, with the audience? Okay, back to the live show. Act 2. Groundhog Day. I had the experience a couple of years ago that a friend of mine became roommates with Bobby Kennedy's daughter, one of his daughters. And she said, do you want to meet her? You know, do you want to meet her? She's really nice. And I was like, we're not supposed to meet the Kennedys. Like, the Kennedys, that is too famous for us to meet. Like, that's too famous for a normal person to meet. Do you know what I mean? Like, the super famous are over there, and we are over here in our world, and we're not supposed to run into Angelina Jolie at the CVS, you know? But you know, sometimes...
She's saying, tell it to my heart. Anyway, I love Taylor Dane. And not ironically. I love Taylor Dane. So I went back into the party. And I went up to her and I said, excuse me. I'm sorry to bother you. But I just have to tell you. I love your voice. And she just turned and said, yeah, I don't do that anymore. Then I looked over and this other friend of mine was doubled over laughing at me. She's like, yeah, you just got dissed by Taylor Dane. Didn't feel great. So I left the party. Then like 9 months passed. I happened to be out to eat with that same friend of mine, Pam. There was a party of 10 seated right behind us. You guys are not going to believe who was sitting there. Any guesses? Just think about... What's that? That's correct. It was Taylor Dane. Pam said, oh my gosh, you have to say something. I said, no question. Because I still love Taylor Dane. But I didn't know what to say to her. And then I realized the best thing that I could say to Taylor Dane would be the exact same sentence. That I said the first time. So I turned around, and I interrupted her entire dinner. And I said, excuse me. Sorry to bother you. But I just have to tell you, I love your voice. And she said, my speaking voice? I said, yes. I was sitting here with my friend. I heard someone talking behind me. I said, I need to turn around and compliment this person on their speaking voice. And what I didn't realize at the time was that Taylor Dane was pursuing an acting career, which I guess is why she was no longer accepting compliments. And her singing voice. Then like a year passed. And at this point, I've told all of my friends about my run-ins with Taylor Dane. And how she's the easiest person in the world to run into. Like, I'm not even convinced that she's not here tonight. So I was at my writing partner, Kyle's house, and my phone rang, and it was Sarah Silverman. And at the time, Sarah was dating Jimmy Kimmel. And Sarah called and said, guess who's promoting a new CD on Jimmy's show tomorrow night? You guys will not believe who it was. Yes, it was Taylor Dane. You're good with patterns. Ted, I want you to come down to Jimmy's show tomorrow night. And I want you to say those exact same words that you said the other times. And I said, no questions. But I didn't end up having to go to Jimmy's show the next night. Because that same day, that Sarah called me at Kyle's house. Kyle and I took a lunch break. We ordered lunch to be picked up. We walked across the street. To the strip mall where the restaurant was. Kyle was walking in front of me. I was walking behind him. We walked up to the restaurant. He opened the door. He looked at this table. Then he looked back at me. Then he looked back at the table. And I was like, she's here. And Kyle and I walked over to the counter where our food was waiting for us, and Kyle was just pacing back and forth, about to have a stroke. And I was like, what is your problem? And he said, nothing, I'm just really uncomfortable right now. I said, why? And he said, because I know what's about to happen. I said, yeah. And I can't wait to do it. I said, this has nothing to do with you. I said, this is between me and Taylor Dane. I said, but what I do need you to do, when I go up and interrupt your lunch, I want you to take my cell phone and just point it in the general vicinity and videotape me talking to Taylor Dane, just so I finally have proof. And Kyle said, okay. So I walked up to Taylor Dane's table. And I said, excuse me. Sorry to bother you, but I just have to tell you, I love your voice. And she said, thank you. And I was like, oh, that was weird. But the best part was when Kyle and I went back and looked at that video footage, you didn't hear me talking to Taylor Dane. You just heard Kyle in an imaginary conversation going, oh, hey. Hey, man, what's going on? I'm having lunch at the chicken cafe, at the pizza cafe, at the California Chicken Kitchen Pizza Kitchen Cafe. So the person that Kyle made up in that conversation was the world's most difficult human being that will not let the easy stuff slide. The person on the other end of that call is going, whoa, 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 back up, dude. Where are you having lunch? At the Chicken What Cafe? Nah, man, I've never heard of that place. This conversation is going no further until you make it clear to me where exactly you're having lunch right now. I feel confident that I'm the reason Taylor Dane ended up putting out another record. Because you know she called her manager and was like, I can't twist me. You love me. I mean,
she's sitting on this stool on stage. Her arms are crossed. She's looking sort of skeptical. And Taylor's trying to win her over.
And our love is love.
Of a mile, keep left. Continue on route.
Let's go warm up. Imagine skiing down that hill. Or mountain ski and recreation area.
Chester's room in 3 weeks. I hear him up there, muttering. I hear the bed squeak as he acts out his violent fantasies. I hear the menacing orchestral strings and explosions and tortured screams that emanate from his favorite games. Problems don't just go away. Problems get bigger. And before you know it, they're bigger than you are. It's too late to fix them. Some days when I've gotten a cup of coffee, gotten a decent night's sleep, I think, sure, I'll just get on the phone, start calling people up and asking for help. A school guidance counselor, a marriage therapist, a pediatrician, a witch, or a shaman, or a wizard, or a physicist, or whoever in hell might know what to do about the portal, and even have the balls to walk down that path and see what's become of that clearing. Other days like today, when I'm too damn tired even to reach for the phone, the only emotion I can summon up is longing for a time when the world was miraculous, when I couldn't wait to get up in the morning and start living. I mean, the magic has to come from someplace, right? It's out there, bestowing itself on somebody else's wife, somebody else's kids, somebody else's life. All I want is to get just a little of it back. Is that so much to ask?
Summer in Bargain's Hill, it rained a little. The rain was a regular thing and would come about 2 o'clock in the afternoon. One day, almost as late as 5 o'clock, the sun was still shining. It seemed almost to spin in a tiny group in the polished sky, and down below, in the trees along the street, and in the rows of flower gardens in the town, every leaf reflected the sun from a harness like a mirror surface. Nearly all the women sat in the windows of their houses, fanning and sighing, waiting for rain. Mrs. Larkin's garden was a large, densely grown plot, running downhill behind the small white house where she lived alone now, since the death of her husband. The sun and the rain had beat down so much to Mrs. Larkin. Only by ceaseless activity could she cope with the rich blackness of this soil. Only by cutting, separating, thinning, and tying back in the clumps of flowers and bushes and vines could she have kept them from overreaching their boundaries and multiplying outlaw reason. The daily summer rains could only increase her vigilance and her already excessive energy. And yet, Mrs. Larkin rarely cut, separated, and tied back. To a certain extent, she seemed not to seek what the cries of birds had hushed. The sun seemed clamped to the side of the sky. Everything had stopped once again. The stillness had mesmerized the stems of the plants, and all the leaves went suddenly into thickness. The shadow of the pear tree in the center of the garden lay callous on the ground. Across the yard, Jamie knelt, motionless. "Jamie," she called angrily, but her voice hardly carried in the dense garden. She felt all at once terrified, as though her loneliness had been pointed out by some outside force whose finger parted the hedge. She drew her hand for an instant to her breast. She was clinging to the hope that she stared across the green leaves toward Jamie. A look of docility in the Negro's back, as he knelt in the plants, began to infuriate her. She started to walk toward him, driving the hope vaguely through the flowers behind her. She forced herself to look at him and noticed him closely for the first time, the way he looked, like a child. As he turned his head a little to one side and negligently stirred the dirt with his yellow finger, she saw, with a sort of helpless suspicion and hunger, a soft, rather deprecating smile on his face. He was lost in some impossible dream of his own. While he was transplanting the little shoots, he was not even whistling. Even that sound was gone. She walked nearer to him. He must have been deaf. Almost stealthily, bearing down upon his laxity and his absorption, as if that glimpse of the side of his face, that turned away smile, were a teasing, innocent, flickering, and beautiful vision, some mirage to her strained and wandering eyes. Yet a feeling of stricture, of a responding hopelessness, almost approaching ferocity, grew with alarming quickness about her. When she was directly behind him, she stood quite still for a moment, in a queer, sheathed manner she had before beginning her gardening in the morning. Then she raised the hoe above her head. The clumsy